Welcome to episode 246 of FBI Retired Case File Review with Jerry Williams. I'm a retired agent on a mission to show you who the FBI is and what the FBI does through my award-winning books, blog, and podcast case reviews with former colleagues. Today, we get to speak to retired agent Josh Mayers, who served in the FBI for 27 years. During his bureau career, Josh was assigned to the Washington Field Office, WFO, and the Milwaukee Division's Madison Resident Agency. In this episode, Josh reviews his seven-year-long investigation of Sinovel Wind Group, an 18% Chinese state-owned wind turbine manufacturer, along with three individuals for conspiracy and the theft of trade secrets and proprietary software from American Superconductor Corporation, AMSC, a U.S. company headquartered in Devon, Massachusetts, with offices in Wisconsin, Beijing, and Austria. AMSC estimated the economic harm from this theft was approximately $1.2 billion and 600 jobs. In 2018, Josh was awarded the Assistant Attorney General Award for Exceptional Service, and in 2019, he was awarded the Executive Office for the United States Attorney's Director's Award, both in recognition of his work on the Sinovel investigation. Currently, Josh is an assistant adjunct professor in the Center for Law, Society, and Justice Criminal Justice Certificate Program at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. He also works as a private investigator and security consultant in Wisconsin. Now, before we get to the interview, I want to let you know that I am now officially an award-winning author and podcaster. Woohoo! On September 18th, at the FBI's G-Man Honors Salute to Heroes event held at the Four Seasons Hotel in Washington, D.C., I gave the keynote address and received the FBI Agents Association's Distinguished Service Award for my continued support of the FBI family through my podcast and books. Next week, on December 8th, I'll upload the audio from the entire event as a special podcast episode. Have tissues nearby because you'll hear some powerful testimonials from the family members of fallen FBI martyrs and some of the agents themselves before their end of watch. A highlight of the evening was when my dinner date for the event, FBI Director Christopher Wray, blurbed my books and my Little Jerry FBI bobblehead to the audience of 400 people from the investigative, intelligence, and security community. Reader team members will get an advance peek and a few of the photos from the elegant gala, along with my review of the Showtime series Billions, when they get my reader team email on Friday, December 3rd. If you don't see my reader team email in your inbox on Friday by the end of the day, you know what to do. Check your spam filter and promotions tab. To join my reader team, there's a link in your podcast app's description of this episode. Thanks again for your support. Now here's the show. I want to welcome my guest, Joshua Mayers. Hey, Josh, how are you?
I'm doing great, Jerry. Nice to talk with you today.
I've done a few intellectual property cases, and they all have been fascinating because usually we have an opportunity to learn about an industry or a product we didn't know about before. And this is a great example of that because we're going to be talking about wind turbines today. And to tell you the truth, I don't know much about them.
I didn't know much about wind turbines either when I started this case. I'd been in the FBI for a number of years and worked a wide variety of cases, but had never really known much about green energy or wind turbine technology at all until this case. So I was learning as I was doing it. So it was quite an experience.
And I think that's one of the fun things about being an FBI agent is all the different situations that you can find yourself in. So this still is a pretty unique one.
Yeah, but you're absolutely right. You know, in the FBI, you get to do things and meet people and have experiences really unlike any other job in the world. I think it's quite exceptional. And this is a good example. You know, this case started back in 2010, and it took 7 years from the start to the prosecution and resolution for the victims. And that's another sort of trademark of the FBI, is to stick with something, right? We open cases that are often big cases. We don't know where they're going to take us. And this was certainly the case here. And it took 7 years to resolve it, along with some fantastic federal prosecutors. We stuck with it and had a good resolution at the end. But it started back in 2010 in the summer.
I'd like to go right to the basics and explain or describe what a wind turbine is.
Sure. So a wind turbine is, most people have likely seen them when they're out driving around the country, perhaps. And, you know, they're these large, they almost look like large, I don't know, insects or birds. And so they're converting the wind, the natural wind, through the large blades of the wind turbine that connects to gears. And then the gears connect to hardware, which then has software on the hardware. And that converts that turning blade that's turned by the wind ultimately into electricity, which gets pushed out onto the power grid. So it takes this natural, you know, wind that we all have and turns it into electricity that we can use without bad byproducts, without any greenhouse gases or emissions being created. So it's green, it's clean energy.
All right. And how does that relate to theft of intellectual property?
Intellectual property really has to do with trade secrets. And trade secrets can be just about anything, Jerry. They can be an idea or a formula or a design or a pattern. And they really have to have three components to be a trade secret that's protected by the law. So they have the trade secret, whatever it is, if it's a design or a unique idea, it has to have its own economic value. It can't be readily known or ascertainable by others. And it also has to be something that the owner took reasonable measures to protect or keep secret. So those three components we had in this case, and the trade secret at issue here was software that the victim company, American Superconductor, had developed and spent a lot of time and money on research and development to create this unique software, which was a trade secret that was proprietary that they owned. And that trade secret ran the wind turbine. It helped keep the wind turbine stable. It helped convert those turning blades to electricity and pushed the electricity to the grid. And the software that was proprietary, the trade secret of American Superconductor, was critical in the operation of the wind turbine.
I think before we actually get started, people listening need to understand, what's the big deal about software and proprietary information? Why is the FBI investigating something like this?
Well, you know, we want our companies and the employees in our U.S. companies to collaborate and work together. And our U.S. companies spend a lot of time and money developing products, developing ideas. And this software was something that American Superconductor had spent an awful lot of time and hard work and money on developing and implementing for their main customer, Sinovel Wind Group, which was a Chinese state-owned wind turbine manufacturer. And so why is it a big deal? Because we want to make sure that our company's intellectual property and trade secrets are protected, that they can't just be stolen or misappropriated by people or companies that want to not invest in their ideas and in their research and development. If they can just steal that proprietary information, it is a big disadvantage to U.S. companies. And it is something that the federal law protects. There are statutes that protect this, that the FBI is charged with investigating. It really comes down to stealing someone else's ideas or products. And so at its basic level, it's theft. And in this case, as in any FBI case, as you know, we look for the motive. You know, what was the motive for stealing the software? I'll describe the actors in this case, but Sinovel, which was one of the defendants, is a corporate defendant. You know, what was the motive for stealing this? They were, Sinovel was American Superconductor's best customer at the time, back in 2010. And what we learned was that they had been paying a lot of money for this software and made an initial attempt to steal it, which was discovered by the victim, American Superconductor. And instead of confronting Sinovel or embarrassing them or calling them out, American Superconductor made a business decision because, as I said, Sinovel was their best customer at the time. So they made a business decision to not offend Sinovel or confront them about the theft that they had uncovered. And instead, American Superconductor put some protective measures in their software. They build in some encryption. They build a timing limitation in so that the software would stop running if Sinovel stopped paying them. So these protective measures that they put in place in 2010 thwarted Sinovel's efforts to steal the trade secret, the software, at the time. And that caused a reaction on Sinovel's part to have to go and recruit an insider. And that's what they did. The motive for this really came down to greed on Sinovel's part. They didn't want to pay the millions, hundreds, tens of millions, hundreds of millions of dollars in licensing fees that they were paying American Superconductor to use their software, to use their trade secret.
This behavior is so egregious. I mean, to have been caught and then thwarted and then to work around that in order to continue to steal the software is just unbelievable.
Well, it gets to your question early on is why, you know, why do we care about this? And really the basic answer is there were hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars at stake here that Sinovel was paying to use the software. And Sinovel was under a lot of pressure from the Chinese government to retrofit thousands of wind turbines who were not performing well and were having grid stability problems in China. So there was a lot of economic pressure, business pressure on the company. So that pressure combined with the basically greed of not wanting to pay for something they had been using and licensing, yeah, it created this environment where they went and recruited using sort of classic espionage tactics to recruit this inside employee. We didn't prove or establish that the Chinese government was behind this. So I want to be clear. This was a publicly traded company in China, Sinovel Wind Group, traded on the Shanghai Stock Exchange, 18% state-owned enterprise. So that's a little confusing. In China, the government or the state owns percentages of certain businesses, like the green energy sector, because it's viewed as a critical key asset, part of their infrastructure. But it's a company. It's not a government here that was charged with doing this. We charged the company as a defendant criminally, which is kind of unique, even for the FBI in some ways. You know, we charge individuals. And in this case, we did indict the three main individuals responsible for stealing the source code.
Well, I can't wait to get into the details of this case. It's a cross between a white-collar crime case of intellectual yes. property theft and a counterintelligence espionage case. They're using the same type of tradecraft tools that you hear about in a spy
exactly.
case.
Exactly. Let me start a little before the FBI got into the case, and then it'll set the stage, I think. Back in 2010, Sinovel was contracting with American Superconductor. Sinovel's a Beijing-headquartered wind turbine manufacturer. American Superconductor is the victim company that's also a publicly traded U.S. company based in Massachusetts. American Superconductor, AMSC, had offices in Beijing and in Massachusetts, and then they also had two offices in Wisconsin. So that's how the Wisconsin angle gets in here. They had a software design team in Middleton, Wisconsin, which was actually about a mile from the FBI office, coincidentally. So in 2010, things are going along fine. Sinovel has contracts with AMSC for both the software that's running their wind turbines and also for maintenance and upkeep of the wind turbines. And so some American Superconductor engineers went out to a wind farm, a Sinovel wind farm out in the Gobi Desert in China, a very remote area, which is where often these large wind farms are. That's where the wind is in these wide open areas. And the AMSC engineers realized fairly quickly that the wind turbine, which should have been shut down and not running, was running, and it appeared to be running on software or running some type of program that was not authorized or was not approved. So they did some checks and they took some downloaded data to test back at American Superconductor in their Klagenfurt, Austria office, and pretty quickly realized that their software had been hacked and that what was running on the wind turbine in the Gobi Desert in China that they went out to service was an unauthorized or unlicensed version of AMSC software. So they realized that they had a real problem. And that was in the late summer of 2010. AMSC's reaction, you know, could have been to confront Sinovel, could have been to either stop their business relationship or demand Sinovel do something differently. And they suspected Sinovel. I don't think they had real proof that Sinovel had done this, but they suspected Sinovel was doing this. Who else could really get access to the wind turbine? And so they took some protective steps. Instead of confronting Sinovel, they put some encryption on the system to prevent future intrusions, and they put a runtime limitation on, sort of like in the old days when you'd have, you know, WordPerfect or something, and you'd buy, you know, a 90-day trial run. If you didn't pay for it after 90 days, the software would stop running. It's sort of the same thing. If Sinovel stopped paying, or if AMSC wanted to stop the software from running, that they could, this runtime limitation would shut the software off or shut it down. So those were the protective measures they took, and then they moved forward and continued the business relationship. Well, unbeknownst to AMSC, Sinovel then, sort of like a chess game, you know, there's a move by Sinovel to hack in, then there's a counter move by AMSC, and then there's a move again by Sinovel. And the move by Sinovel in the fall of 2010 was to recruit Dejan Karabasevich. They knew Dejan. They knew about him because he had been an engineer for AMSC working in China. He'd been servicing the Sinovel contract. So Sinovel knew Dejan Karabasevich. They liked him. He liked working in China. He made friends with his Chinese counterparts, and he liked spending time in the field, climbing these wind turbines, staying days at a time out on these wind turbines while he serviced them. AMSC, which had acquired this small company in Klagenfurt, Austria called Windtech, they wanted Dejan Karabasevich to come back to Austria. They wanted him to be, he was a sort of a rising manager in their company, and they wanted him to be back spending more of his time in the Austria office supervising the software development team. He wanted to be in China climbing wind turbines and having all sorts of girlfriends and extramarital affairs. And so this tension created, and Sinovel saw that tension. They heard Karabasevich complaining about how he was perceiving his treatment by AMSC, and they recruited him and offered him a lucrative contract and made it clear that they wanted him to steal the software and make some changes to it. The changes were primarily taking off the protective measures that AMSC had put in place. His motive was really one of revenge and wanting to, I think, hurt American Superconductor and make big profits from Sinovel, who offered him a $1.7 million contract to steal the software that ran and operated these wind turbines. And so that started in the fall of 2010. And then by March of 2011, we learned that Karabasevich had, in fact, without permission, gotten into the server that was in Wisconsin. So you've got the parent company in the United States, the subsidiary in Austria, and to find the source code for Karabasevich to be able to locate the source code, it was stored on a server of a supervisor with American Superconductor in Middleton, Wisconsin. So that's how the FBI in Wisconsin, which was my field office at the time, got the case. You know, we learned later, we didn't even have a case open at this point. So March of 2011, Karabasevich puts his notice in with American Superconductor. He's going to leave the company. He doesn't say why. And in Austria, they have a personnel, like a human resources policy, that you can use your remaining vacation time, they call garden leave, which means you don't really leave your position. So he resigned in March, but he had until June basically to stay on the company books. It's just an Austrian human resource policy. Karabasevich exploits this. In early March, when he gives his notice, he downloads the source code from the server in Wisconsin. So he commits the crime in early March, right about the same time he's giving notice that he's going to resign from AMSC. And then he uses a little sleight of hand, like many criminals. He uses a subtle but very critical manipulation. He tells the HR person in the office that he's going to be traveling while he's on his 3 months of garden leave, and he would like to continue to do some work remotely, and he wanted to have some access, and would that be okay? He, of course, didn't tell them what he was really doing. She approved that, and he then puts a laptop in a docking station in an unused office in Austria so that he can remote access the server. And so that little sleight of hand, American Superconductor doesn't really check on or try and verify it, gives him continuing access to the source code. He downloads the original version of the source code and then takes off on his garden leave. Well, instead of traveling around Europe, which is what he told his colleagues and friends in Austria, he heads right for Beijing and spends the next 2.5 to 3 months in a luxurious two-story safe house in Beijing that Sinovel has rented for him, has put him up in with his girlfriend. And they also create for Karabasovich, Sinovel creates a test bench. They create a sort of a mini laboratory for him with components, hardware and software components from the actual wind turbines, the critical components that the hardware that contains the source code and the software. So they put in this apartment for him components so that Karabasovich, at their direction, can take the manipulated and stolen source code and make changes to it and adapt it for Sinovel's use. And so that's exactly what he does.
Could he have done this and still remained with the company?
Well, that's a good question. He could have, I suppose, downloaded the source code like he did and transferred it to Sinovel and continued to try and work for AMSC. I don't know whether, I mean, at some point, I think Sinovel's clear goal here, a clear plan was to stop working with AMSC. So I don't think he could have really continued with AMSC because the plan was to stop paying AMSC the hundreds of millions of dollars a year in licensing fees. And so eventually the gig would have been up and AMSC would have realized what had happened, I think. So I don't know that he could have continued at AMSC. And he didn't want to. He was angry at AMSC. He was very disgruntled. He was somebody who felt wronged, even though AMSC had helped him. They had sponsored Karabasovich as a young graduate student from Serbia, a very bright young man. They saw the promise in him. They brought him to Austria from a small mining town in Serbia. And they brought him there and sponsored him and tried to help him, help his career. And so they wanted him to come back to the headquarters and continue to, you know, rise in the managerial ranks. Karabasovich didn't want to do that. He was also involved in a marriage that was falling apart because of his own infidelity. You know, basically he was cheating on his wife, who was also an AMSC employee at the time. And so Karabasovich had a lot of issues going on in his life and felt he was undercompensated, wanted, you know, things. So he makes this decision. He goes to China for 3 months. Then he comes back. He comes back to Austria in June, late June of 2011 to see his young daughter. And I think to clean up his affairs and plans to move to China and begin working for Sinovel. That's pretty clearly his plan at that point. The victim company, however, realized during that three-month period that something was amiss. Sinovel had started cutting off their business relationship even before Karabasovich made all the changes to the source code. Sinovel was already sending very direct, clear messages to AMSC that their business relationship was, if not completely over, was going to change significantly. And so AMSC began investigating as a company. And one of the things they did was go to the Austrian government and go through the U.S. Embassy in Vienna to get help because they're a U.S. company and they felt a crime had occurred in Austria at first. And so they went to the U.S. Embassy in Vienna and got help with the Austrian law enforcement authorities. And when Karabasovich comes back in June to clean up his affairs before permanently moving to China, he's arrested by the Austrian police in Klagenfurt.
In addition to Sinovel advising that they're going to be cutting back on their relationship, on their contract, was the company suspicious also because they knew that Sinovel had attempted or actually operated intellectual property theft before? Were they suspicious that they had done it again?
Yes. Yes. They clearly remembered that Gobi Desert discovery in 2010, that their software had been hacked and they put on protective measures. And so they were very aware. Yes, they connected that up early on. I don't think it was until later, till March, April, May, that they realized that there was an insider who was also involved in this. That took later to figure out and culminated in Karabasovich's arrest in Austria and his limited confession he made. So by June, late June, AMSC is aware not only that Sinovel is behind this theft more than once, as you indicated, and that they've recruited one of their own employees to further attempt to steal the source code and harm the company. So by June of 2011, that's pretty clear to AMSC. And in fact, the Austrians do a good job. They arrest Karabasovic. They get a confession, a limited confession from him, and begin to understand what's happened. The problem is the Austrian law doesn't really allow for this type of crime on this scale. So the harm here, even then, the harm was in the hundreds of millions of dollars. It later was assessed to be over $1 billion loss for the company. But AMSC in 2011 was certainly aware that they were at risk of losing hundreds of millions of dollars in revenue from this theft. And so the Austrian law just didn't really take into account. So Karabasovic was actually convicted of stealing the source code, and the punishment was 9 months of sort of home detention, where he would be out working during the day and go in at night to a correctional setting. Wow. For like 9 months. Minimal punishment.
In the United States, the dollar value, especially for white collar cases, is drives the sentencing exposure.
Exactly. That's right. The economic loss exactly is often tied to the sentence. And so in this case, there was no real justice. The victims felt there was no justice. There was no restitution, no money paid to them to compensate them for their loss. And so when American Superconductor went to the U.S. government at the embassy, the ambassador at the time, who had been a businessman and had been in the private sector, I think even maybe worked in green energy sector, perhaps, after he heard what had happened, he walked down the hall and knocked on the legal attaché's door. And for your listeners, the legal attaché program is an FBI program, which is really one of the greatest strengths of the FBI, and that we have FBI agents and now analysts and professional support employees overseas full-time in U.S. embassies around the world. And so the FBI agent in the Vienna, Austria embassy, when the ambassador walked down the hall to tell him about this U.S. company that had been victimized in Austria by a Serb national who had stolen their software, that FBI agent understood just what you're talking about. He understood that this was a white-collar crime, that this was, although a violation of Austrian law, it was likely a violation of federal criminal law as well. And in sort of just the beauty of the FBI and the small, it's a small world type of feeling in the FBI, the LEGAT at the time was a great agent named Steve Paulson, who had been in the Madison FBI office with me for 7 or 8 years. So I knew Steve just coincidentally.
Yeah, small world after all.
So when the ambassador left his office and he realized there was a Wisconsin connection, he picked up the phone and called first the United States attorney. And it just so happened, as a coincidence, I was sitting in the U.S. attorney's office that morning when Steve called from Austria and described what had happened and said, you know, really, he just needed a lead covered at this point. He wanted to see if we could cover a lead for him. And he was calling the U.S. attorney to get a sense on whether there was any jurisdiction, you know, in the U.S. and where it might fall. And so we began looking into it. This is what the FBI really does well at. We have a global reach, and we have a standardized system of, you know, looking into criminal activity when there's an allegation such as this. And so it didn't take terribly long to sort out that this was a U.S. company and that the software had been sitting on a server in Madison, Wisconsin. Then we had to decide with the U.S. Attorney's Office's help, where was the jurisdiction? Was it going to be in Boston, where AMST was headquartered? That could be one place. Was it going to be in Madison, Wisconsin, where the source code was sitting on a server when it was stolen? So that had to be worked out. Ultimately, jurisdiction fell to the Western District of Wisconsin. And in another sort of moment of the Bureau's strength here, you know, the Boston field office is a big office, very, very good office. We know of their work, you know, more recently in, say, the Boston Marathon bombing case, really great field office in Boston. And so, you know, they didn't get the case. A small Midwestern field office got it, and even a smaller resident agency, these satellite offices in the FBI in smaller towns in the state.
Who made that decision?
That decision was made by the U.S. Attorney's Office in Boston and in Madison. They, just like most jurisdictional decisions, where can we prosecute this case? If there is a case to prosecute, who has the best opportunity to prosecute and where is the law going to fall on jurisdiction and venue. And so the prosecutors decided it, but the strength of the FBI is at the Boston office. You know, they could have been a little upset by that. They didn't have any problem. They just supported our case for 7 years. They couldn't have been more gracious. So again, the strength of the FBI is leveraging those resources. So here we're a small Midwestern field office with what's turning out to be a quite significant large white collar crime case. And also with cyber and as you said, it's sort of economic espionage elements to it, fairly complex.
Had you ever worked a case like this before? Had you even worked an intellectual property theft case before?
No, I hadn't. I was in my early 50s. I was, you know, a few years from retirement. I had worked, like most FBI agents, I'd worked counterterrorism matters after 9/11 for sure. And I had actually worked counterterrorism matters for many years before 9/11 in the Washington field office. And I'd worked violent crime for many years, gangs and drugs. And I'd worked some white collar cases and some counterintelligence cases, but I had never worked an intellectual property theft matter. It wasn't really a high priority back in 2010.
So why did you accept the case? Because you could have probably gotten your supervisor to give it to somebody else just by saying, I haven't done this before. Let somebody else who knows what they're doing do it. Why did you decide to do it?
Well, that's a great question. And it really comes down to there's sort of a twofold answer. One is that my former colleague and friend, the Legat, called and you know, needed help or expressed, hey, I've got a, you know, the ambassador just came down the hall and is telling me about this case. So I felt some already interest or need to help because he had called directly. But really, the real answer is that the FBI, I mentioned this resident agency concept. We, you know, in the FBI, there are big offices, the headquarters city office. Every field office has a large headquarters city office. So if it's in Wisconsin, it's Milwaukee. If it's in Illinois, it's in Chicago. But the strength of the FBI throughout the state is these small resident agencies. It's really the best job in the FBI to be a street agent, a case agent working in a small resident agency. You really become a jack of all trades and a master of many. So that's really the reason. The beauty of being in that small resident agency as a senior case agent or field agent was you could pick and choose the types of cases you wanted to work. And you worked a broad, diverse array of investigations, which is really the beauty of being an agent. You know, you can have 10 or 15 careers in one because you work all these different violation or federal criminal statutes, and you really become immersed in them and you learn about them. And so, yeah, I'd never worked intellectual property. I'd never been to a wind turbine or seen a wind turbine, but this was a new area of work and one that intrigued me. And so that's the strength of the FBI, really, that you can have that flexibility and freedom to let the job sort of take you where it will.
I totally agree with that.
Yeah, it's sort of a subtlety, but it's a strength of the FBI. So I opened the case in October, late October 2011, and we start investigating. We start gathering information. We start working closely with the victim company. And that's another sort of critical lesson learned in this whole case is that often companies who have been victims of crimes, victims of particularly this type of crime where their intellectual property has been stolen, companies are sometimes reluctant to make this public. They're reluctant to report the crime to law enforcement. You know, I've read some about
because
the
of
reasons
their shareholders and things like that.
Yeah, right. Exactly. They're worried about shareholders. Well, they're worried about negative publicity, which to your point about shareholders, they sometimes are. We know that the trade secrets oftentimes are at the greatest risk of being stolen by employees who are leaving. Often when there's a failed business relationship, and then sometimes when there's corporate espionage, you know, one company spying on another. Those are the typical times when we see intellectual property theft occurring. And if it's a failed business dealing or a disgruntled employee, that's also embarrassing for the victim company oftentimes. So there's a reluctance often to report these crimes. And so we worked very hard. You know, I'd spent my whole career working with crime victims. And again, it's one of those parts of the FBI agent's job that can be challenging, but is also very rewarding. So whether it's, you know, a victim of a bank robbery or a victim of a complex, you know, white collar crime, the FBI takes great pride in working closely with victims of crime. That's really, you know, it kind of is the motivation for all of us behind this. And in this case, the victim wasn't just a big corporation. The victim here were the 600 or 700 AMSC employees that lost their jobs as a result of this theft.
Oh, tell us more about that. Yeah. How did it affect employment?
Yeah. So they had a huge loss of stock revenue because of the theft. And they also lost all of the contracts from Sinovel, the hundreds of millions of dollars of contracts from Sinovel. So AMSC had to let go over 600 employees. So when I first started going to their Middleton, Wisconsin office, when we began the case in the fall of 2011, and, you know, met with the engineer who was the supervisor on the software development team, whose server held the software that was stolen, and met with some of the other engineers who had been working in the Austria office. So we began to interview people. That's really how the FBI starts most cases, is you start talking to people. And so as I started going out and working with the victim company, I realized that they had a great number of employees who were very committed to the company. And every time I'd go back, each month I'd go back to the office, there would be less and less employees there. And eventually the Middleton office was just empty desks for, you know, as far as you could see. And eventually that office closed. So all of those employees were put out of work because of this crime.
And I take it that really brought home to you what this theft meant to the company. It put faces to a corporation that got stuff stolen from it.
You could see the harm, exactly. So, you know, for example, the head of HR, a lovely woman, very smart woman named Susan DiCicco, she was the head of HR, a vice president in charge of human resources for the company. She ultimately testified at trial about having to lay off every single employee and how hard that was on her. You know, employees that had been longtime friends, employees with kids, you know, in college, employees who had bills to pay, and how she had to personally let go each of these employees until finally the president of the company, Dan McGann, came to her and said, you know, there's no one else to let go. And she realized really she was being let go and had to fire herself. And the impact of that, you know, not just on me as the agent and on my colleagues in the FBI who were working on this case, but that really impacted the jury when they could hear from this woman who was directly affected by not only having to fire all of these hundreds of employees who lost their jobs, but ultimately she fired herself. You could just see the jury was rapt attention when they heard her testimony.
That's devastating. And I can understand how unsatisfying it is when, what was his name again?
Karabasovich. We call him DK because it's a kind of a tough name to pronounce. Dayan okay. Karabasovich. We call him DK for sure.
Okay, good. I'll call him DK. Yeah. So I can understand DK. How unsatisfying it must have been when DK got his 9 months in Austria, because the partner in the theft, which was Sinovel, is at that time untouched, right? They haven't been sanctioned or fined or hurt or jailed or anything.
Right.
They're getting away with this.
That's right. And they got away with the software. So because DK did transfer to Sinovel, to his handlers, the source code. So with the source code, then they've got the crown jewels. It's not just that they have the software that's running, but when they get the source code from DK, now they can make changes to the software. They can adapt the software. They really have the crown jewels of AMSC at this point, and they don't need AMSC anymore. And so, yeah,
wow.
That's right.
That says
all
a lot.
Those victims.
Yeah, they don't need AMSC anymore.
That's right. That's right. It was very clear. And as the U.S. attorney said, John Vaudrey, the U.S. attorney on the sentencing, said, this was attempted corporate homicide. Sinovel tried to kill a U.S. corporation, which is really true. They tried to put them out of business and kill them. So the seriousness of the crime, even though we think of it as just a white-collar crime, there were human beings behind it. And we set out to investigate it. And that's what we did. The case took an interesting turn. You know, we were investigating the theft of the software and the transfer of the software to the Chinese company. But in 2012, we learned something that was quite interesting. Actually, later in 2011, we learned that part of what we were trying to do in the FBI, in my case, in my investigation, was to understand who is Sinovel? Where are they located? And they did have a small office in Houston, Texas. They were trying to expand into the U.S. market. There are a number of different wind turbine manufacturers around the world. Sinovel at the time was number three in the world, and they had aspirations to be number one. So they were trying to export their wind turbines, and they were exporting wind turbines around the world with American Superconductor software running them. And so we began to theorize with the victim company, is Sinovel exporting their wind turbines with stolen software or with the proprietary software that they've paid for and have a right to use? Because they were paying for a licensed version, but then they stole an unlicensed version and modified it, so they didn't need to keep paying for it. So we began to wonder what's running on those wind turbines. And in late 2011, we learned that there was a plan to export 4 wind turbines to Massachusetts, 1 to Charlestown, 1 to Scituate. Charlestown's just outside of Boston. Scituate is down the coast, south, sort of towards the Cape. And then Fairhaven is down the coast.
How bold. This company is now exporting wind turbines right in the backyard of AMSC in Massachusetts with the headquarters in Boston.
That's right. And you're exactly right. And to add insult to injury, they're going to get Sinovel requested a special waiver to import Chinese wind turbines into the U.S. And one of the ways they got the waiver was to articulate that they were using U.S. licensed software on their wind turbines, Massachusetts produced. So, of course, they should be allowed to import these into Massachusetts because they're running good old USA software made in Massachusetts. So that was one of the things they did, as you say.
Sounds like a confession.
Right, audacious. And then also, they, in addition to running U.S. software, they also got some stimulus money. The owner-operators, there were U.S. owner-operators of these 4 wind turbine projects, business people who were doing these wind turbine projects as an investment. And those owner operators received federal stimulus money for using the green technology and for using the Sinovel wind turbines. So it really was a poke in the eye of AMSC, as you said, in their front yard to export wind turbines into Massachusetts. So we began to wonder, you know, are they running the good software or the stolen software? And so that gave us an opportunity. That question created an opportunity for us. And as many times in the FBI, you know, you have opportunities that are created or you create your own opportunities. And this one sort of was created for us. And we began to plan for and think about and discuss, can we do a physical search? Can we, you know, the FBI, as you know, Jerry, is pretty good at searching buildings, right? We can search rooms and houses and hotels and cars. And, you know, we're pretty good at conducting searches. We do search warrants, we do consent searches, and we do that to try and gather evidence of criminal activity. And so as I began to explore the options, could we do a search of a wind turbine and do a search of the hardware and the software, much like if you did a search of a house and found a computer, you would search that computer's hardware and software if you had probable cause to believe that there was evidence of a crime on that computer. Well, it's no different here. It's just taking it a little outside the box and became sort of a mantra for us to think outside the box.
Or up the box in this case.
Or up the box, right. 300 feet up the box. That's right.
Wow. Can you equate, you say 300 feet?
300 feet, yeah.
Yeah.
30 stories.
Thank you. That's what I wanted to know. 30 stories.
Yeah.
Okay.
30 stories up. And so, you know, we needed to learn about wind turbines. So we sort of began a masterclass on wind turbine technology. You know, what are they? How do they operate? What do they contain? And we couldn't have done this, frankly, without the victim company. Again, it's this partnership, right, between the FBI and the victim that gets formed. And you're there to serve the victim, and the victim has rights under law, but you're also there to form a relationship and to communicate and to listen.
When you're talking about that communication, you are in Wisconsin, the AMSC. Headquarters is in Boston. Now, you mentioned this before about the Boston office helping you out. Can you talk a little bit about the FBI's lead system and being a lead agent and a case agent and how that worked in this particular case?
Yeah, it was really critical here. It's a great point. So we're the office of origin. Milwaukee and Madison, Wisconsin become where the case is sitting. And then Boston became the main office where our leads were, because Boston and Austria, frankly, but Boston because of the headquarters. So I would travel to Boston to have meetings with both executive team and managers and lawyers at American Superconductor. And Boston assigned parallel case agent in Boston, Scott McGaughan, a great agent, an older agent like me in his 50s, he had had some white collar and a lot of cyber experience, much more actually than I had. Really great guy, though. Just a one, you know, a case agent's case agent, a person who was really good at talking to people. He had a lot of contacts in Boston, and he was instrumental, really. And Scott worked on this case with me, even though we were in different field offices and our office ultimately got the case assigned. I would call Scott the co-case agent to this day. He was just a partner through and through. And so he facilitated not only all of the communication with the victim company, but we began also to carve out a parallel relationship, Jerry, with the owner operators, the business folks who had purchased the Sinovel wind turbines and were installing them in the three cities near Boston. And so those owner operators, we also viewed as victims. They were not witting to what Sinovel had did. We didn't know yet, by the way, if Sinovel was running the licensed good software on those Massachusetts wind turbines, or if they were running the stolen modified software. We didn't know the answer yet, but that's where we were headed, to try and get that question answered. That became a critical question to answer in late 2011, early 2012. And the Boston office also helped broker a relationship with the owner operators, who became really like secondary victims. It was very clear they didn't have anything to do with this theft, and they had purchased these wind turbines and assumed there was licensed legal software running on them. And if there wasn't, then they were also victims in this case. So we took that approach with them, and they were really just excellent to work with. And so the Boston agent facilitated both the victim communication and the cooperating witnesses, who were the owner operators.
And where is this software, where is this evidence located that you're going to now go search for?
Right. So the software is sitting on two key pieces of hardware, one at the bottom of the wind turbine and one at the top. So there's a large electrical control system cabinet at the base of the wind turbine, and that holds something called the programmable logic controller, big long name for something we call the PLC. The PLC is one of the pieces of hardware that connects with another piece of hardware at the top called the power module. And those two pieces of hardware talk in milliseconds to keep the wind turbine functioning and keep the electricity stable as it gets pushed to the grid. So the PLC and the power module work in conjunction. Those are pieces of hardware. One's in a cabinet at the base, one's in a cabinet at the top. And running on those two components are proprietary software that AMSC developed. And it's that software that DK stole and then modified and changed for Sinovel. So we now have to get into the cabinet at the base and into the cabinet at the top and image or copy the software running on those pieces of hardware and then do a comparison, side-by-side comparison, because we had the licensed proprietary software from the victim. We know what that looks like, and that can be compared against the software that's running currently on a wind turbine in Massachusetts and see how do they compare. Are they the same or are they different? That was our goal. That was our challenge.
And tell me there's like an elevator that takes you up 30 stories.
Right. No. In this case, there's no elevator. You know, it's enclosed. First of all, there are no windows. You go in the base, you go up a few stairs, and you go into the stalk, kind of the ground floor. And then there's a ladder against the wall, and the ladder has a channel or a track in the middle of it. So you wear a climbing harness like you'd wear, you know, for rock climbing. And then it has a particular type of device that you clip into that center channel of the ladder. And that's an arrest device. So if you were to let go or to become unconscious or to slip, that will hold you in place. It will arrest your fall. So you will not fall down the ladder. So you're clipped in, you know, it's safe in that regard. You're clipped in and you're just climbing a ladder. So when you climb in 80-foot sections, and then there's a platform, a metal kind of platform, and you could stop and rest, or you can also just stop on the ladder and lean back against the stalk of the wind turbine. So it's really not that difficult. In this case, the primary challenge was, how can we get in to the wind turbine? These were functioning operational wind turbines. How can we do it safely? There's a lot of voltage and a lot of electricity running through these things. And then we had another complicating factor here, Jerry, in that I think I mentioned Sinovel imported or exported from China these wind turbines into Massachusetts. And along with that, the contract to export them went a service agreement. So like a warranty. So the owner operators had a 2-year warranty on the wind turbines, and Sinovel sent 5 or 6 of their technicians from China. They put them up in a house in the Boston area, and they had connectivity to the wind turbines and would service them. So they would monitor their efficiency. If something went offline or there was a problem, they would go out to the site and do the repair or figure out what was going on. So we had to get in, we had to do it safely, and we also had to do it really under the noses of the main targets here, Sinovel, because their employees were in the area. That created some investigative challenges that are not uncommon in the FBI, and we came up with a good plan. And first of all, we practiced. You know, the FBI does a lot of searches, but we always practice and rehearse first. So we did, with the victim company engineers, we did a lot of practice and rehearsal. They have engineers that climb these things all the time. They trained our tech agents and our card agent in Milwaukee. We had a tremendous computer response team that are the cyber experts. So this agent in the Milwaukee office was a very senior cyber agent, and he began to train with the victim company on how to climb, and more importantly, how to access the software once you get the control cabinets open, you get the pieces of hardware opened up. Now it becomes a matter of how do we do that cyber digital evidence search in a way that's both, you know, is going to both be safe and is going to protect the evidence we gather. So we're going to attach something called a write blocker. It's a little more detailed probably than you want, but we're going to do this in a way that preserves the digital evidence. So all of this comes down to doing the search safely and doing it in a way that preserves the evidence that we're going to recover. That's true in any search of the FBI, and it was true in these searches too. So we began to plan for this and practice, and we did our first search March 28th of 2012 in Charleston, Massachusetts. First wind turbine put there, site of a wind turbine was erected by the Massachusetts Water Authority. And we did the search in broad daylight, kind of the concept of hiding in plain sight. We had the owner operators shut the wind turbine off, and we used the ruse of a grid, you know, like a state grid inspection. We actually told Sinovel through the owner operators that a grid inspection was going to be occurring and that the wind turbine would be offline for a couple hours during the day, and that the technicians weren't needed on site. And if they were needed, that the owner operators would contact them. So we kind of hoped, we just kind of took a chance that by doing it sort of in the open, but also using this ruse, would be successful. And in fact, it was. The Sinovel engineers didn't seem to really have a clue what was going on. At one point, they showed up, but they didn't come inside, and nothing, you know, we weren't detected. And so we spent 6 or 7 hours there the first time with, you know, 40 or 50 agents and support employees from the Boston office, and a number of us from the Milwaukee office came out to do the first search. And
okay, I have to ask you this because you keep saying mm-hmm. we.
Yeah.
You went up too?
Well, this is the thing about being the case agent, right? You're sort of the conductor of the orchestra. So no, I didn't go up on this first search because I'm really overseeing the operation. So I've been up to the top. I've climbed these and did these in practice. But really, it's the cyber agent and the tech agent who were charged with doing the physical search and gathering of the evidence. And that's what they did. The case agent, as you know, is kind of the conductor. He's or she is the one overseeing the operation. And of course, I had a little unique pressure from both FBI headquarters and my field office and the Boston field office management. They were a little nervous we were going to break these things or get hurt. So there was a fair amount of handholding to be done. I was there on site. I didn't go to the top. The card agent and the tech agent from Boston went up and did a good search.
Yeah. And let me say that that is normal. On any FBI case, if an agent needed to have tech agents legally break into a house or something right. in order to install equipment or to do a electronic or digital search,
yes,
the case agent isn't going to go in
That's
with
right.
those tech agents who
That's
are
right.
are trained to do that.
Exactly. You're in the command post or you're in a car nearby. But exactly. You're overseeing this, but you're letting the experts whose job it is to do the technical expertise of that installation or of that evidence gathering mission. So, and that's the case here. These professionals were exceptionally good. The tech agents in Boston and our card agent, Matt Peterson in Milwaukee, had trained and practiced. They had the equipment, they had the knowledge, and they just did a splendid job. Did it perfectly well to the letter of the law. and most importantly, gathered evidence, which we were then able over the next few months to compare. And we were able to, for the first time, see very clearly in black and white that what's running, not only now did DK steal the software from the Middleton, Wisconsin server when he was in Austria, not only did he transmit that to Sinovel and make the changes that they requested, now Sinovel has imported into the US at least one wind turbine we know of that's also running the stolen modified source code. It wasn't running the licensed approved source code that the owner operators had paid for and that Sinovel had paid for. They were running on those wind turbines the stolen source code. And that was a real aha moment for us when we saw those test results. And it took a few months to get the test results back from the lab to show definitively this is also the stolen unlicensed code that they're running. So that kind of invigorated the investigation, I would say. We sort of took on a new level of energy at that point. The prosecutors, I think, got more invested too. Not only did we have sort of a distant crime, we had a very immediate crime happening. And then we began to look at the other three wind turbines that were down the coast of Massachusetts and contemplated, well, if it's running in one, it's likely running in all four. So we did another search in May of Scituate, the wind turbine at Scituate. And then in December, we finished the last two in Fairhaven, the last two Sinovel wind turbine searches. And in all four wind turbines in Massachusetts, they were all running the stolen modified source code that DK had stolen. And that really pushed the case, I think, to a different level.
Were there other places that Sinovel had wind turbines throughout the United States other than the new contract they had in Massachusetts?
No, there were no other Sinovel. It's a good question. No other Sinovel wind turbines yet in the U.S. They did have a Houston office, and we did learn that they were trying to expand into the U.S. marketplace. So these four were the first, but they did not have any others up and running at that time. And we went and served the Houston Sinovel office with a grand jury subpoena, and they fled the country. They closed the Houston office and fled in 2 days. All their employees were pulled out. So again, another indication that maybe we were on the right track here.
Sinovel is just unbelievable. I don't know who their corporate heads are, but it sounds like they had absolutely no hesitation in using all these deceptive practices in order to save money.
Yeah, it was really eye-opening that the company would go to these lengths to not just out of greed or out of an effort to save money. It was really more than that, as you're, I think, indicating. They really went to great lengths to try and hurt AMSC. I mean, AMSC, they had been a customer of AMSC's and a good customer. And, they had negotiated contracts and done some hard negotiating over price. But that's what companies do who are working together, contracting with each other. But this was a whole nother level of really corporate greed and aggression that, it's really why we do this in the FBI. These cases were not a huge priority in the early 2010 timeframe. Now, today, they're a much bigger priority in the FBI. I think last year I saw some public statistics saying the FBI had opened 1,500 new intellectual property cases in 2019 or 2020. Well, that's a lot compared to what was being worked in 2010. This was sort of a new area, and it wasn't, there had been intellectual property cases in the FBI before. But this was the first time we also sought to take on a corporate defendant. One of the things that's a little bit unique about this case, I think, is, we had the three individuals, right? Individuals commit crimes. We always think of, people commit crimes. So DK, he committed a crime when he, without authority, downloaded the software from the server, right? That was a crime. Sue and Zhao, the two Sinovel managers who recruited and handled DK, and who actually received the stolen software in an email. Sue received an email from DK in June with the final version of the modified source code. We recovered that email when we did searches on some email accounts. So those three individuals committed this crime, right? And so we think of crimes being committed often by people. Well, in this case, interestingly, we began to consider charging the company with a crime. Corporations are not people, but they can be charged with criminal activity if we could establish that the crime committed by the company was done at the direction of its officers, right? So if it's a corporate policy, or if the corporate action is being done by the agents of the company or the employees of the company, then the corporation itself can be charged with a crime. And that's exactly what we did. We charged not only the three individuals, Su, Zhao, and DK, with stealing the source code, we also charged the Sinovel Corporation criminally in federal court. And that's the first time in this case, is the first time that that's ever been done, I believe, charging a Chinese corporation in U.S. federal criminal court. And so that became the trajectory of the case after we completed the searches of the four Massachusetts wind turbines in late December 2012. Then in the following June of 2013, we indicted in a grand jury indictment in Wisconsin. We indicted the three main individuals, Dan Karabasovich, Su Liang, Zhao Haichun. And then we indicted Sinovel Wind Group Limited, the Chinese corporation, for stealing AMSC's proprietary source code. And that was a big deal. And then it took a number of years in the courts to fight it out. But that's where we landed in June of 2013, after we did our evidence gathering and after we compared that evidence to what the victim company gave us to compare it to, which showed that this was stolen software running on these Massachusetts wind turbines. Pretty dramatic.
Absolutely. The court fight, what did that entail? Because most people would assume in a case like this, there'd be some type of settlement. I mean, right. Why would a corporation want to go to trial?
That's right. Good question. So they hired, Sinovel hired a big expensive law firm at first to defend them. And that's certainly their right and would expect that. One of the things that we did, we served Sinovel with notice and we served them through the Houston subsidiary. Sinovel had a U.S. subsidiary here, which was operating at the time in Houston. And so when we charged them, we notified Sinovel through the Houston subsidiary. And so their first legal challenge was that the U.S. government had not served the Chinese corporate defendant properly, that by serving the Houston subsidiary, that was a U.S. subsidiary, it wasn't the Chinese parent. That took 2 years to litigate. It went all the way up to the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals in Chicago. And ultimately, we prevailed, but it took 2+ years of legal wrangling back and forth and oral argument before the Seventh Circuit held for the government that we had, in fact, properly served the Chinese corporate defendant. So that's sort of a legal technicality, but it became a very important legal question, procedural question, because if foreign companies are outside the reach of the U.S. government, even if they're doing business in the United States, what does that say about our ability to hold foreign companies accountable in the U.S., right? And to hold them accountable for not breaking our laws or stealing our company's technology. If we can't reach a foreign defendant through, say, their U.S. subsidiary and their U.S. employees, then companies are going to be able to commit crimes and get away with it if they're beyond the reach of the government. So this was an important procedural point. The rules of criminal procedure actually were modified and changed after this ruling by the Seventh Circuit to account for serving foreign defendants through their U.S. subsidiary. So it was a very interesting legal question, and it ended up having a good result, but it took a while. It took, 2+ years. Then Sinovel fired their U.S., their big expensive U.S. law firm and hired another big expensive U.S. law firm. And then we began on the road to trial. Trial prep and pretrial motions, pretrial suppression hearings, all the normal things that you see in the federal criminal trial process. So it took another 2.5 to 3 years to get to trial. And ultimately, in January of 2018, we had an 11-day jury trial in Madison, Wisconsin. And after 11 days, the jury deliberated for only a couple hours and came back after lunch with a guilty verdict. So not only did they find that Sinovel had done this at the direction of their corporate executives, the restitution amount that the judge ultimately levied against Sinovel was upwards of $57 million. And we also had an $850,000 restitution amount levied against Sinovel for the victim owner-operators as well. The folks I mentioned who cooperated with us, who were the owner-operators of the four Massachusetts wind turbines, they were also victims. They suffered economic harm and loss because of this theft as well. They also had to now go and retrofit those four wind turbines with licensed good software, not the stolen bad software. And so they had suffered harm as well that we were able to demonstrate in court. The victim owner-operators testified. We brought in the Austrian police officer to testify with a translator. We brought the Austrian engineering team to testify. After 11 days, we rested and the jury got it. I think they really saw that this was a case of, as the U.S. attorney had said, a case of attempted corporate homicide. That really resonated with just the local Wisconsin jury, you know, when they heard the harm and they heard from Susan DiCecco, who was the HR woman who had to lay off 600 employees, including herself at the end. That really resonated with the jury, I think.
And at trial, who was present representing Sinoville?
They had an empty chair at the table. Just the lawyers. So I don't know if that, I don't know how that was perceived by the jury. They certainly, you know, legally have a right to not have a physical appearance in court.
DK
is a fugitive. He's still to this day. I interviewed DK in an Austrian courtroom back in 2012, I think. And shortly after interviewing him, he fled Austria and, as far as I know, is back in Serbia, which doesn't at present extradite their own citizens for these types of crimes. There's an old extradition treaty from 1901 that doesn't contemplate intellectual property theft, and he was not extraditable at the time I left the FBI. So he fled back to a small mining town in the mountains of Bor, Serbia. And then the two managers, Sue and Zhao, they were indicted and charged and have federal arrest warrants out for them and also Interpol red notices. Interpol is, you know, the international police agency, which helps with international fugitives. And so in theory, they can't travel or leave China at this point. They would be subject to being picked up on the red notice if that happens. So there are three defendants still fugitives at large, but the corporate defendant was found guilty and ultimately did pay approximately $57 million. They paid that restitution to the victim, and they paid the $850,000 to the other victims, and they paid the U.S. government a fine of about $1.5 million, which was a statutory capped amount. But they did pay those fines and restitution amounts, which is kind of interesting.
Yeah,
whether they did that because they wanted maybe to have a chance to do business in the States, not quite sure what their calculation was when they decided to pay those amounts. They also waived their appeal. So that, you know, I guess they made a business decision there too, perhaps. I don't know what went into that decision making on Sinoville's part, but I do know that they did fulfill their obligation and pay the restitution amount that the judge set at sentencing, which was not an insignificant amount, although still pennies on the dollar compared to how much ultimately was lost. I mean, it sounds like a lot of money. It's, you know, it's incomprehensible. $57 million is a lot of money. But compared to the hundreds of millions that they lost and the 600 plus employees that lost their jobs, those employees didn't come back to work, as far as I know.
So at the end of this, you know, you talked about all the people being laid off. Mm-hmm. Did the company survive?
Yeah, AMSC, American Superconductor, is still in business. They've been able to rebound. I don't believe most of those employees who lost their jobs as a result of this crime came back, but the company has been able to survive and I think has found out ways to adapt and pivot. But this was certainly a significant event in this company's history, and it affected many, many of their employees significantly.
You talked about starting this case when you were in your 50s.
Right.
And then you talk about working this case for 7 years. And we all know that the FBI has a mandatory retirement age of 57.
This was the end of my career. It was my last sort of big case that I worked. I'd had other big cases that had had good results, but this was kind of it. I could have put it for an extension even, but I decided to retire after this. I felt like I'd brought it to a good resolution, and it was just kind of a good place to end things. So I was able to retire shortly after the trial verdict. You know, you want to go out on your own terms and you want to do it at the time and manner of your choosing. And it just seemed like a good way to cap what I felt was a great career and can be very challenging. It can be stressful on family and loved ones to be an FBI agent, but there's no better job in the world. And I'd had a lot of travel throughout my career overseas, gathering evidence, talking to people, interviewing folks. This was an extension of that. And I just felt like I'd sort of done what I could do. And it was time for other younger agents to step up and take my place. That's another strength of the FBI. You know, if one of us leaves tomorrow, there's 10 better agents waiting to take your place, you know? So it's really a great strength is the people. The people are what makes the FBI great.
I totally agree. So I want to now go to my standard question. When and why did you join the FBI?
For me, it was sort of the very common reason I've heard many agents say over the years, you know, I wanted to help people. I think that's certainly true. I'd been a police officer for a few years before I joined the FBI in New York City in the 1980s. And I had a chance to work on a case with an older Russian-speaking FBI agent that I was just fascinated by, that this guy would come help us on a small criminal case that needed a Russian speaker. And I ended up working with this agent for a week, and he just spoke to me about his career and his job, and it really intrigued me. It was in the mid-80s when some of the big spy cases were happening. You might remember Walker or Whitworth, and then a little later Ames. Sort of spy espionage cases, you know, that was something only the FBI did, and it intrigued me and interested me. And so I began, you know, in the 80s, sort of working towards the goal of becoming an FBI agent based on that limited experience working with an agent in New York and just being intrigued by the types of cases the FBI worked.
Wow. In a way, that came full circle then.
Yeah.
I mean, your interest started with, you know, spy and espionage cases, and it ends with one that is closely associated with that type of violation.
Right. And really, the FBI is, I mean, there are other agencies that do that type of work, national security work, but really the FBI is the lead on that. And it's very unique to the FBI.
So you did retire shortly after working this intellectual property theft case. What are you doing now?
Thanks for asking. I'm doing some security consulting, some private investigative consulting. And then my main job is teaching at the University of Wisconsin in their Center for Law, Society, and Justice. It's a undergraduate program for legal studies majors and criminal justice students, and just really enjoy working with young people, our next generation of, you know, police officers and prosecutors and defense attorneys, getting to work with some really bright, hardworking students who are trying to figure out their place in this crazy world. I had a lot of people help me, Jerry, up through the years in my career, and it's sort of a way to pay back and help the next generation of criminal justice professionals. So that's kind of my main job these days, and it's a labor of love. So I enjoy the teaching and mentoring of students.
I'd love to ask you for your last words. What would you like to say?
Well, thank you. And it's just been a pleasure talking with you today. The thing about this case is just emblematic, really, of the FBI and my career. And the FBI is really thinking outside the box, being willing to take risks that are calculated and thought out and planned. Being an FBI case agent, you're really the conductor of the orchestra, like I said before. Searching these wind turbines that had never been done before, there was some pushback and concern, but, you know, just thoughtfully and methodically sticking with a case for the victims. That's the whole motivator, really, is getting a good result for the victims who have suffered as a result of criminal activity. This is what motivated me in this case and in many other cases over the years.
And that's the end of the interview. At jerrywilliams.com, in the show notes of this episode, you'll find a photo of Josh Mayers, a longer version of his bio, photos taken during the climb and search of those wind turbines in Massachusetts, and lots of news articles about the precedent-making trade secret theft investigation. Don't forget to look out for my December reader team email and next week's special podcast episode from the FBI Agents Association's G-Man Honors Salute to Heroes Gala event with FBI Director Christopher Wray and me. I hope you enjoyed the episode and that you'll share it with your friends, family, and associates. And make sure you follow FBI Retired Case File Review on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, or your favorite podcast app. This podcast is all about true crime, but if you're also interested in crime fiction, once a month via my monthly email, I keep you up to date on the FBI in books, TV, and movies. When you join my reader team, you get access to my FBI reading resource, which is a colorful list of more than 50 books about the FBI written by the FBI agents who have been guests on this podcast. There's nonfiction, crime fiction, true crime, and memoir. I would also love it if you checked out the link for my books in your podcast app's description of this episode. My nonfiction books, FBI Myths and Misconceptions, A Manual for Armchair Detectives, which goes through 20 cliches and misconceptions about the FBI in books, TV, and movies. And then there's the companion book, FBI Word Search Puzzles, Fun for Armchair Detectives. My FBI Philadelphia Corruption Squad crime series features flawed female FBI agent Carrie Wheeler in Pay to Play and Greedy Givers. All of my books are available wherever books are sold as ebooks, print books, and audiobooks. If you've already picked up copies of my books, please consider leaving a review. Reviews help readers find good books. Thank you for listening to the very end, and I hope you come back for another episode of FBI Retired Case File Review with Jerry Williams. Thank you.